chairman, all the panelists, I think the main agenda for this panel is to see what opportunities are there in green finance. To Jeff, Koi just mentioned that Kenya issued its first green bond and raised $42.6 million. We would like to hear from you, from a regulator's perspective, how was the experience and how did the market take it?
Thank you, Noah. This is an industry-led initiative. We partnered with the Kenya Bankers Association and Climate Bond Initiative to come up with a project task force under the partnership of the Central Bank of Kenya government. And the whole idea was to actually develop a framework for issuance of green bond in Kenya. Our initial intention was to issue one within the banking sector because we have the information, we have the banks have a lot of funding for green activities, and we felt that we needed to issue like an industry bond that would actually be able then to refinance all those green opportunities. But as the framework evolved, it took a length of its own, and it actually became like our major master framework for the country. And through that initiative now, we were focusing on identifying those opportunities, coming up with capacity-building initiatives, trying to create a platform for verifiers to come through. And that then gave birth to a bigger understanding, especially within government, that this particular sector has to be developed. And so we started getting the push to amend our regulations to accommodate green financing, and we were able to amend our regulations, our bond market rules to allow for green finance issuances. And then we also pursued the direction of engaging the government to provide these sort of opportunities, tax incentives, and some tax exemption status. And that was granted this year. And so it actually became a very well appreciated initiative to the point that the government also intends to issue a green bond, and with our task force within the national government to issue a solid green bond. So that appreciation, working closely with the Kenya Bankers Association as our mentor partner, gave us quite some impetus to engage the private sector. And we started engaging the various respective private sector players in the housing sector, in the energy sector, and we're very delighted with income. We're able to come forward and boldly say that we should be more. And using our rules, we were able to make that application to the Capital Market Authority, and that was actually approved, and we were delighted that we were able to do it. So this is also out of the fact that Kenya has a very great opportunity for green bond financing. If you look at the energy sector, we have renewable energy. 90% of Kenya is now with more renewable energy generation, and with more than, especially along the geothermal space, housing, infrastructure, healthcare, all this. So it's a very great opportunity.
The interest is increasing. In part, we think because of the nature of green finance or green bonds issuance, you usually target projects. The first project that was targeted around renewable energy. So we see it as a very good way of fostering macroeconomic development in terms of impact. The other impact to also look at is in terms of market liquidity. Total issuance size now is around $836 million added to the existing capital market instrument. So it provides decent trading opportunities in local markets. The last impact would probably be around awareness. Prior to now, it was just conversational talk. But going out to that, to actually do an issue, obviously provides investors as well as issuers the opportunity to actualize the whole conversation. And so we have seen two other corporates issue on the back of the successful federal government issue. And it's very important to point out that the first one that was issued by the federal government was the first sovereign green bond, climate bond initiative certified that was issued in the continent, and also the fourth to be issued in the world. So we feel that this impact that we're seeing around the liquidity, around the interest, can only be positive. Why do I say that? If you look at the way our pension industry is configured, at the moment we have close to $26 billion under management. The sort of investment that you have made so far is less than 1%. Okay, so whereas in normal conventional bonds, they invested close to 47%. So we think that issuers will not have the opportunity to issue. The major challenge we have in the industry or the environment has been around demand supply imbalance. Obviously, the oversubscription is coming from the fact that you don't have a lot of issuances. But we have been able to work around that. So recently, the stock exchange went into an MOU with Luxembourg Stock Exchange. As you know, Luxembourg Stock Exchange obviously is the leading exchange around green bonds. So what that do is to foster cross-border listing and help improve liquidity across both markets. So we're very excited about this whole initiative. The other thing to bear in mind also is around investor education. The Nigerian Stock Exchange is also a part of a member of the United Nations Sustainable Stock Exchange. So what that gives us is the not just the primary status, but the ability to also go out and create a framework, a level environment to allow other aspects of this green finance to be fully actualized, especially in the areas of product creation, asset-backed securities, data green finance, but more importantly, the involvement of retail participation in the whole issuance and investing framework. So it's something that is gaining momentum in Nigeria, and we're excited about it. And we think to a large extent it will even help finance the various projects deficit that we see in the local environment.
Thank you very much. I noticed that you spoke a lot on the supply side, and there's a lot of growing demand also coming up. You mentioned the pensions asset under management is still very huge. Just a follow-up question on that. So are pension funds really seeking green investments, specifically to their policies have been aligned, or a portion of their assets under management? Are they really going for specifically green investments?
It's a new area, obviously, requires a lot more market awareness, market education. The thing about yields in Nigeria, yields are pretty high, to a large extent, the green finance or the green bonds that are issued typically trade below the regular bond issuances. But what we have seen, just on the issuance side, is in terms of tenure, in terms of the yields that we're seeing, the interest is beginning to pick up. And on the back of the framework that will allow the pension fund industry to invest in this instrument, that is also ongoing conversations around that, especially we have a regulator that regulates the pension fund industry, called PENCOM. They also are very aware based on our last sustainability report that was presented. So those conversations are ongoing. But the beauty of it is that the amount in terms of asset allocation for green finance is really not situated. So it's like a virgin land that gives them the opportunity to grow as much as they want to grow. So we think that the sort of interest around the yields and around the specific projects, and once conversation is understood that really the only way to grow is in a sustainable manner. So we expect the government to begin to issue larger funds, but more importantly, we expect the PFAs also to begin to invest in these instruments. As you know, the yields in Nigeria recently have come down significantly around the fixed income levels. Obviously, the government through the CBN is pursuing a policy that will allow credit to filter into the system. So we're not seeing all those crazy yields that we used to see before, the 16.5, the 15.5. So we expect more projects to finance under this initiative. And we expect the PFAs to come on board in an aggressive manner. I mean, the major challenge, like I said earlier, is around identifying the projects, going through the whole process of issuance, the discipline, the framework, the certification, and subjecting to the reporting as well as the review of the projects along lines of the issuance exercise. That requires a bit of discipline. But we think that with the MOU, we have a lot of box of the change. We'll definitely unlock the ability in the global market, which is now a major challenge. Because the guys who hold these instruments typically don't want to sell, because they're not so many issuances. But we expect more issuances across all borders, and we also expect transactions to occur, not just on the leasing side, but also on the trading side.
Okay, thank you very much.
Start off by giving a genesis of the development of the green market in South Africa. We face substantial infrastructure financing requirements. Our national development plan estimates that around $65 billion or close to $975 billion, will be needed in the next few years for infrastructure investment in energy, clean water transportation, waste management, and climate adaptation initiatives. We've been working very hard in driving social responsible investment for the last 17 years, and since we hosted the SME in 2002. Since then, we've been working hand in hand with our issuers on sustainability and managing our impact through disclosures. In May 2004, we introduced the sustainability index, measuring companies or indicators that are related to environmental, social, and governance issues. We, in 2012, ourselves together with the stock exchanges of Brazil, Egyptian stock exchange, Bursa, Istanbul, and Turkey, and Nasdaq, we launched the sustainable stock exchange initiative. Also to mention, as part of our ongoing listing requirements, JSC requires that companies that are listed on our board annually report on the extent to which they comply with the King Code. Actually, King 4 includes sustainability and integrated reporting as a measure of compliance. In 2015, the Sustainable Responsible Index was replaced by a FTSE JSE Responsible Investment Index Service. That is the partnership between ourselves and UK and FTSE Russell. This was also created to identify companies which are leading in ESG practices. And then lastly, in 2017, we launched our Green Bond segment, together with our green listing rules, to help and promote the further green bond issuances.
Thank you very much, Dr. Salient. Your time is limited, so before I open the audience for Q&A, I would like each panelist in less than 30 seconds to say what other African countries can do in terms of capturing the opportunities in green finance. So, I'll start with Koi.
Right. Well, I think that coming from us, in terms of the experience that we've got, the policies that come out from, like the tax exemption status, getting tax exemption status, a lot of investor education is necessary, and just providing the framework for investable green bonds and green investment alternatives. I think that can come a long way in helping future. And also there's a perception that going green is expensive, but it really isn't. So again, just that education that it is not that expensive, and it is actually something that is of financial benefit to the issuer.
Spot on, going green is not expensive. I'll now ask Jeff to give a brief remark on the opportunities.
I think it's a great, this is the future. The whole conversation around global climate change and the risks we face should be something that all embrace as even investors and as exchanges. And we moved it together around the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative, come together and really understand this. But I think each exchange needs to really begin by having a base that understands the opportunities around green bonds, encouraging more listed companies to undertake integrated reporting and sustainability reporting, because when those companies start adapting to those, then you see bonds being issued in the market. First, develop a sustainable index so that we encourage investors to those who have social impact interests to actually know the companies that are providing that. And as Corey said, more education and more engagement with policymakers towards ensuring we bring more incentives. I think the catalyst to the market will be see more government and international issuing bonds in the market that agree, because as you said earlier, the corporate leaders have been big, basically private organizations, and the more financials, the more sovereign issues come to the market, the confidence built around this assessment. So I think those are the direction to take as a respect to this.
Thank you. So stakeholder engagement and creating awareness on green finance is also key for opportunities. Julie, what's your perspective on the opportunities?
The opportunity globally is huge, just given the sort of issuances we've seen this year. Based on report from Family Bond Initiative, it's about $867 million last year, and it's likely to close this year around $180 million. And the whole sustainable issuance is around $30 trillion. So it's something that Africans cannot shy away from. And I think the earlier we start it, the better for the investors as well as also the issuers. I think the two critical areas, as mentioned by the other panelists, will be around the regulatory framework for issuance. That is key. The stock exchanges very quickly have to form the framework, the legal environment, the rules that will allow for these listings. And then the second element will be on investor education, issuance education. At the National Stock Exchange, we have a training program called X Academy. X Academy offers training, investor type education training, and that has been very helpful. You bring the issuer, the various stakeholders, and you need to provide all the required information that you need to go through the process and how it will work. Also bringing international facilitators to provide the required insight as to how this thing work. But more importantly, there's no choice in the matter, right? So sustainability is sustainability, and we have to do it for land. Global best practice. So it's easier done when you move from conversation to actual practical demonstration of what it is that it is. So I think sooner we begin to provide the right investor education and issuers education, then we'll be able to see issuers. But I think it's always easier for the sovereign to issue first. So they set the benchmark, and that will allow the corporates to come in and begin to issue.
Thank you very much. So he's mentioned about the standards and the understanding of the issuance process, which is also very important to allow for new opportunities. And lastly, Tato.
I think from my end, we are getting a lot of inquiries from issuers looking to issue in a new form of sustainable type of bonds. We're looking at revising our framework to expand the use of process model to include the likes of blue bonds that would also help in financing water infrastructure projects. We are also getting a lot of inquiries also on the social impact side of things, where we want to get our listing requirements aligned so that we create an enabling environment for this kind of instruments to be issued.
Thank you very much. So, again, thank you.
So, as I alluded earlier, the government is looking to issue a green bond, and this is currently the task force coming up with the framework of how to fund fair issuance. The municipal bond is going to be part of that conversation, because currently we have a non-destruction Kenya, and a number of them have certain organizations that want to issue green bonds, especially infrastructure like water, even local green park. But the challenge has been how do they raise this money, given that they have no mandate to do that at the moment. So we don't have a framework yet of how to allow municipal bond issuances in Kenya, and how to protect those receivables will become part of the thought process in the future. I think what we're looking at now is government raising money centrally as part of more national infrastructure development as opposed to independent county development. So it's part of what we'll be discussing with them and see how these counties can raise money in the municipal, because there's actually a push coming through the system.
Thank you very much. Thank you. If I can answer the second question, I think the green bond market uptake is only slowing in Africa, as you alluded correctly. Globally, the market has raised more than 250 to 300 billion in green investments. And whether in Africa we're going to make it through investor education or stakeholder engagement, I think the difference here is that green bonds have an foremost identification of proceeds. So we are not just raising money and using them wherever the governments or the corporates feel like. The money is specifically for certain environmentally related projects, and also it is very transparent and it has high levels of governance. Every year, the issuer has to do an annual reporting to show where the money which was raised is actually going to those projects, and the amount which has not been raised, what the company is doing. So I think in terms of whether Africa we can do it, I think we can do it. We are the ones which are the most vulnerable in this market in terms of climate change, whether you believe it or not. We face it in our lives every day. So I think, yes, it is doable to make a greener Africa. So thank you very much